Radio you can touch.
Showtime.
Are you ready?
I'm ready. Are you ready?
Here we go.
Ready.
This is the Bob and Jeff Show, starring Bob Lutz.
Feels like old home week.
I know what you mean.
Jeff Lutz.
Definitely old home week when you're here.
I hear you loud and clear.
And Jason Duda. For today, anyway.
It's old home week?
Are you saying I'm old or that I should be in a home?
Yes.
Alrighty then.
97.5 and 1240 KFH.
Stand by for action.
This is Steve Kerr, head coach of the Golden State Warriors. You're listening to two guys who have the heartbeat of the heartland, Bob and Jeff, on KFH Radio, Wichita.
Wow! Hello, everybody. Yeah, we're feeling it today. The Bob and Jeff Show here on KFH Radio. Bob Lutz, Jeff Lutz, our friend Jason Duda in on a Monday. Our friend Steve Kerr with the introduction to the show.
How about that?
We appreciate Steve getting to that. I wasn't sure he was going to be able to, but a little arm twisting, and we made it happen.
Well,
thoughts,
Raymond
Duda?
Ritter made it happen.
That's something. I mean, there you go. You'll probably use that every day now for the rest of your
days. Did we only get Steve this year?
We'll get Steve.
No, I mean, did we only get the Steve intro?
Yeah, we only have Steve.
Because we've had Draymond. We've had Steph.
Who else did we have?
Iggy.
Andre Iguodala.
Yeah. I think we had Klay Thompson, didn't we?
We have had Klay. So we need Andrew Wiggins.
We need Chris Paul.
Oh, that'd be cool.
We'll make it happen.
Sure we will.
Was
Steve Kerr, he was on the show, right?
He was on the show.
And Jerry West.
And Rick Barry.
And Bob Myers.
Bob Myers was on the show.
That's pretty legit.
We are Warriors Central.
I guess we are.
When it comes to Golden State Warriors, and they start their season, I believe tomorrow night. They have the back end of the TNT doubleheader against the Lakers.
Yeah, that's a good one. That'll be a fun one.
And it's the Nuggets and who in the first game?
Lakers, Nuggets, Suns, Warriors.
There you go. There you go. Correcting me already.
Well, standard for every day I come in here.
And the Pacers open on Wednesday against the Wizards.
There is no one who cares.
No, I was going to say, where did that come from and why?
Yeah, there's no one who cares.
The Pacers and Wizards, where did that come from?
I'm watching that. Pacers are my club.
Oh, my goodness.
I just
don't know with you.
I don't get that.
I can't wait to watch the Pacers.
How? What's with the Pacers? How did the Pacers pop up?
I don't know. I just found myself, hey, I need to root for the Pacers. So I delved in, and here I am. I bought the team pass on NBA League Pass. I can only watch Pacers games. I've got a Twitter account dedicated
to the Pacers. How long till he's miserable with that?
Week.
It's basketball. I mean, it's not like it's going to be bad.
Why wouldn't you take the Warriors? You got all these guys that come on the show from Golden State, and Steve Kerr does an intro, and you're like, I like the Pacers.
Warriors are way too predictable, and there
plus
are other
they
teams,
play too late.
Yeah,
could
never watch
stay
their
up
games
that late to watch the Warriors. I would have chosen the Bucks, coached by
Wichita's
own
easy
Adrian
to choose
Griffin.
The Bucks.
Well, okay. Easy to pick them.
Then choose the Bucks. I would go watch the Bucks.
Well, I'd rather watch them than the Pacers.
Well, the Pacers are fun. They score a lot. They're young. They're exciting. I like the Pacers.
Well, yeah, they're 0-0. Wait for a month when they're 3-8.
They're not going to be 3-8. They'll be 5-5, or they're going to be around 500. They're an okay team. They'll get better as the season goes along.
With no future.
What do you mean no future?
None.
Have you seen Tyrese Halliburton?
Oh,
Ben Mathurin?
Oh, Benny.
Aaron Nesmith?
Oh, Aaron.
Aaron. Obi Toppin?
Oh, me. You know it.
Miles Turner, who's still only in his late 20s?
Yeah, Turnsy's going to be good this year.
He will.
Yeah.
It's a bad choice.
And it's a good choice.
If you're going to get into the NBA, which I applaud, I think that's fine. But what about when the Pacers are playing? And so is KU in a big...
I'll be watching the Pacers.
In a Big 12 matchup. What about the Shockers?
It's tough. I don't know.
Well, for the purpose of this show, it'd be nice if you'd watch the teams we talk about.
It would be nice.
Hey, that Pacers but I did magic not, game last night.
But I did not pay $90 to watch the Shockers.
I will say that I will not talk about the Pacers.
No, you refuse.
No, we're doing it right now.
What's the point? After this little shenanigans that you got going here, I'm done with the Pacers.
This is the last time we'll
talk
about the Pacers.
Literally, the only team I don't like right now are the Pacers.
See, that's what gets you in trouble, because when I was talking about Ohio State, well, I'm not picking Ohio State.
I'm not.
When I talked about another team, well, I'm picking against them because you picked them.
I did.
So how'd that work out for you?
I slept just fine this weekend.
But how did it work out?
Well, I don't know.
It didn't.
You didn't do well in your picks, nor did I, nor did Max. Jeff did.
Good for Jeff.
He went 7-1.
That's impressive.
That's the best week of the year that anyone's had. And what are you going to do? You did get him pretty big in fantasy football.
Destroyed.
Congratulations.
Well, and I got a bad team.
No, I have a bad team.
I lost Justin Jefferson.
We all have bad teams.
I got a bad team. Mine's really bad.
I lost Patrick Mahomes and Breece Hall.
Mine's extremely bad.
Yeah, yours is terrible.
Mahomes, you could have used him yesterday.
Would have helped.
Who'd you start at quarterback?
Jordan Love.
What?
Well, you sound like
on
a
blithering
idiot.
You did that on
I
purpose?
Supposed to pick up? I got Stroud, who was on bye. Who do I get?
That's all you got?
Yeah.
Oh, you traded Mahomes.
Well, you would have had Mahomes.
I would have had Mahomes. That's correct. But I didn't.
But you traded him to me, and I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
And I gave up something.
Sort of.
What'd you get in that deal?
I got Garrett Wilson, CJ Stroud, and somebody else.
The running back from...
And Madison.
Minnesota. So, you know. I don't even want to talk about fantasy football because I'm terrible. The only unbeaten team in our league did lose this week. So there's no more unbeatens. There's 12-team league was a mistake. I apologize.
Well,
the teams are too watered down to even be very interesting. It's hard to have a good fantasy team when you got 12 teams.
It is.
No,
that's
not
part of the. That's the way. That's what it's supposed to be.
It's the same. It's the same as if there's a 10-team league.
Well, you
right?
can get better players. You can have more depth on a 10-team
yeah.
league. So
well,
you don't
course.
Have to worry about if you have a couple injuries. You got guys to plug in. Like you get injuries in a 12-teamer, you're just
it's over
throwing a dart.
You look at the waiver wire in a 12-team. There's nothing.
No, that's why I was looking the other day. I'm like, I need to pick somebody up, and I'm like, well, who am I picking up? What's the point?
There's nobody. That's why
there's
you
no
have
reason.
What we're saying.
Jordan Love at quarterback and things like that.
Well, there you go.
You also traded Patrick Mahomes.
Right.
That will define your season.
But I have C.J. Stroud, and he's pretty good.
He's not Patrick Mahomes.
He's not, of course.
Did you just not?
From a fantasy perspective, he's going to put up numbers.
Not like Patrick Mahomes.
Patrick Mahomes runs a little bit more, so that will put him.
And he throws a little bit more. And he's a
Stroud had
three
more
times
yards.
Better quarterback.
Stroud had more yards than Mahomes going into this week. So it's not like it's crazy.
I'd have to see that to believe it.
And one fewer touchdown. I looked it up.
We're in the East Wichita studio today for my first time here in months. And we're here because our old producer engineer Tom Thurber dropped by, and we all enjoy seeing Tom.
Absolutely.
And he reminds me of Michigan State, so I'm going to jump right to that because Tom's our resident Michigan State guy.
Did they play this weekend?
Like, not really.
No, that's what I thought.
I mean,
they were on the schedule though.
It's
yes.
not what happened when they were playing that I want to talk about. It's what happened on their video board in a pregame trivia contest. They ask a question about where somebody was born. That somebody is Adolf Hitler. what they've done, now this came from a third party as part of a YouTube trivia thing, whatever. But it managed to make the video board in East Lansing, Michigan.
With a huge picture of Hitler.
Right. And what they've done is suspend somebody in their communications staff, we don't know who, with pay. That's the punishment handed down from Michigan State.
Here's a few days off, but you got your paycheck. Can I get suspended with pay?
I know, I would love that.
I got a call. Can somebody call UPS for me and suspend me for the week?
That is the most offensive thing I've ever... how in the world are people not getting fired at Michigan State over this?
Well, the guy who runs the thing, he was like almost defending it. He's like, well, it was good information, but a bad venue for it. And if we ignore history, then we'll pay for it. Yeah.
That would be a bad Jeopardy question at this point.
You should not incorporate Hitler into anything.
Right.
We all know Hitler. There's no like, oh, we can't, if we don't talk about Hitler, no one will remember the atrocities.
And to pretend like anybody in the world would care where he was born.
Yeah, no. I don't know. I don't know.
I
what was the answer?
Austria, right?
Yes.
Makes sense why he had ties there. All right.
Anyway. Are you,
what?
I like history. I like that stuff. So that makes sense when he was, I don't want to talk. We're done.
Are we about to, again?
This yeah, is like... I was starting to get down the hole, the rabbit hole, and I wouldn't have been able to get out.
No.
So I'm done.
All right. So there's that, which is maybe the most, I don't even know what to think of all that. So I'm going to stop thinking about it. Then there's the whole USC football thing. They lost to Utah. They've dropped a couple in a row. Their quarterback, Caleb Williams, is no longer in the Heisman race. They're not in the national championship race. So there's been some people suggest that Caleb Williams should sit out the rest of the year to protect himself for the NFL draft and make sure that he goes into that healthy. What world are we living in right now? I'll ask you two. You're 20 years younger. You're 25 years younger. Am I missing something?
What, they've been doing this for years. Guys don't play bowl games. Guys sit out the last couple games.
That's a bowl game.
But what's the difference then? I mean, they're sitting out for the purpose
of going
to the NFL.
What about the people who donate to your athletic program?
Oh, I agree 100%. It's the same thing with the NBA and these guys taking days off as rest days and all these kids saving their money just to go watch that game and then the guys don't play. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. I don't like it in any of the sports.
I don't know what.
You play.
You, go.
You play. If you're on the team, you play. You play it out for the rest of the year. If you're a guy that's in the NBA or Major League Baseball or hockey or football, you play every game. That's what you do. That's what you're paid for.
Well,
if you
baseball,
need rest,
play
rest in the summer.
Sure, you rest some guys occasionally because 162 is grueling. You're playing every day.
Well, you rest if you're hurt.
Well, yeah,
but if you're not,
you
don't.
Rest some guys.
I know.
You save
Look, I know,
guys.
But I don't like it. I don't like it.
Well, I don't care if you like it.
How long? Cal Ripken played for decades, didn't miss anything.
Well, Cal Ripken's a special case.
In what way? Nobody else wants to be a special case?
He never got hurt.
Well, that's fine. If he was hurt, then, yeah, sit him down. But rest days, just to have a rest day, I don't like it.
You're getting off the topic.
No, I'm not.
How do you feel about Caleb Williams? That's what I'm asking you.
He should play.
You sip that
caffeine
over there.
Yeah, which one? I got lots going on. I'm going to be fired up until about 3:25, and then I'm going to have a nap.
What do you think?
What's the question?
Come on, weigh in.
Caleb Williams.
I don't care
out.
What he does. I don't care what he does. But here's my thing. When has that ever happened? When has a guy been a lock for the number one pick in the draft and then gotten hurt? It doesn't happen. He's not going to get hurt. It's very unlikely he gets hurt. If he gets hurt, the worst injury is probably he tears up his knee. He still goes number one. He returns in a year. Nothing's going to happen from him playing these games. I get that there's a risk. You never really know if something's going to happen. But quarterbacks don't really ever get hurt.
And I'm going to be honest. You're starting to go on and on. Which is what you tend to do at times. And
well, I was right.
You asked him to go on and on.
I didn't really ask him to go on and on.
You wanted his opinion. He's given
well,
it.
Well, but he gave it about eight times.
Fair enough.
I'll be honest with you. When guys sit out a bowl game, I don't really care. I think most bowl games are
useless,
ridiculous.
So why do you care if Caleb Williams sits out? That's not going to affect you. At all, right? So,
well, and I'll even change it for Caleb Williams because he is the best player in the country. Arguably, in my opinion, arguably the best quarterback that we've ever seen in the college ranks. So when he doesn't play,
and your crowd comes to the games anticipating to see this great player, that's a slap in the face not only to your institution, but to your fans and to your to everyone who invests in USC. It would be an awful look.
Well, it's not just USC. And, it's college football in general.
And
all sports.
It'll be high school sports. It basically kind of already is high school sports. Just sports.
And if he were to sit out a bowl game, I'd have a problem with that.
Well, because, I don't think they should.
Because people are there to see him, right?
That's why people buy tickets. Like, that's what got me off of the NBA. Because everybody, these guys taking all these rest days.
Wait a damn minute.
Oh.
What'd you just say?
He doesn't owe them anything.
He doesn't owe the fans anything?
Right. That's correct.
Oh, my God.
He doesn't. What does he owe them? Why?
Why?
Yeah, why? I don't get why he owes them something.
Is Caleb making any NIL money?
He could have gone to Louisiana Lafayette and played. I mean, he just happened to go to USC where football is big. People, I guess, want to see him, but that doesn't mean they get to see him.
Then he
that doesn't
went.
Mean they have a right to see him.
Then he should have went to West Lafayette if he didn't care. You don't go to an institution, especially somewhere like that, where football is everything.
I have never in all my life heard anyone say he doesn't owe the fans anything.
He doesn't.
I'm just astounded by
I'll go even hotter take. I'll go even hotter. If Caleb Williams decides right now that he's sitting out the rest of the season, I would fire Lincoln Riley.
And look at him. He picked up
your thought.
Yeah. What do you pick up?
Just drop it. Yeah, drop the headset.
Why would you fire Lincoln?
You can't
Riley?
Get the guy you brought over here to play the whole season out. Then what influence do you really have? Your defense stinks. Who knows what will be after Caleb Williams leaves? So bye.
Riley's on the hot seat already.
No, he's not.
Oh, of course he is. I know he's got a long term deal, but Lincoln Riley is not the fix it guy. All he can do is coach an offense that has a Heisman-type quarterback. That's what else has Lincoln Riley proven?
That's about it.
Look at Brent Venables. One down year, they're right back to being, here they are, undefeated, 7-0. Then they're not great. They're not. Oklahoma still lacks the kind of personnel that we're used to Oklahoma having, but they're 7-0.
Correct. And they got KU this weekend. They'll probably be 8-0.
That's right. So I'm not a big Lincoln Riley fan. I think what he's done has been a disservice to Caleb Williams, even though Caleb has the Heisman Trophy.
He does. And he's going to go number one in the draft.
To?
The Chicago Bears.
What about Justin Fields?
They won without him yesterday.
Well, and we'll talk about the Raiders.
And they look pretty good doing it.
What we have on tap today, Jessie Newell from the Kansas City Star will join us. In roughly 5 minutes, we'll talk about the Chiefs. They looked very good yesterday with Patrick Mahomes throwing for 4 touchdowns. So we'll catch up with Jessie Newell. And my first question to him will be, who is the team that now is in the catbird seat to challenge the Chiefs? It's not Cincinnati. It's not Buffalo. It's not Miami. It's got to be the Baltimore Ravens, right?
Not really.
Not I don't know. Really?
Everybody no, thought... I wouldn't take Baltimore over the Chiefs or in a even...
No, I said that...
I don't
what?
Think. I don't think they're... I don't... No, I don't. I don't think that. I what? Watched the Ravens play the Steelers. They look like garbage. Yesterday, they looked great. This happens
the
to
Steelers
every,
aren't terrible.
This happens to every team but the Chiefs, as I mentioned on Twitter yesterday and have said before.
What about against the Lions in
week
one?
They didn't look like garbage. They lost by a couple points. The Chiefs never play
poorly. Well, the Ravens lost by a couple points to Pittsburgh.
Yeah, but that game stunk.
It's
Week to week. NFL's week to week, boys.
Not with the Chiefs. It's not. The Chiefs are immune to that.
We will take a break. How's that?
Great.
869-1240, the IHOP hotline. Don't forget about us. Give us a call. But next, Jesse Newell from the Kansas City Stars. We discuss the Chiefs. The Bob and Jeff Show with Jason Duda here on KFH.
KFH.
Well, it's always a good thing when we can kick off a week musically with the Beach Boys. Songonyms, the category, that's Do It Again. From the Beach Boys. We'll be playing another song called Do It Again coming up in a little bit. See what I mean?
We're gonna
Songonyms.
We're going to keep doing it again.
Mac, very good.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I go now?
That's really one of your best highest points.
I know.
Points.
That's why I wanted to leave.
Here's Jesse Newell from the Kansas City Star. He covers the Kansas City Chiefs, and they are coming off
a win. He's not on anymore.
We lost Jesse.
He'll be back.
I'm told.
Talk amongst yourselves.
What are you texting?
I'm making sure.
Trying to concentrate on the
show. I'm making sure I can book my people that I'm booking.
Worry about that tomorrow.
I'm worried about it right now.
Do what you're supposed to do today.
Did you see the Victor Wembanyama picture of him blocking Andrew Wiggins' shot?
Did not.
You need to look that up because it's the most incredible thing I've ever seen in my life.
In your life?
Yes. It is unbelievable.
Well, why don't you show it to him? Why don't you get it on your phone and show it to him?
Because it doesn't do justice on a phone. I'll get it for you guys.
Well,
and it's amazing. But I think we have Jesse now.
We do have Jesse Newell. Jesse, welcome. How are you?
Good. Good. How about you guys?
Yeah. So
we're good.
The Chiefs win yesterday against the most pretentious team in the AFC, the Chargers, 31-17. That game was incredible in the first half. Nobody could stop anybody. And then the defenses kind of took over in the second half, especially the Chiefs' defense. I thought they showed the best of both worlds just in different halves.
Yeah, I would agree with you. And I know my colleague Sam McDowell wrote about that today in today's Star and probably tomorrow's Eagle, which is just that this is different. And that might be why this could be potentially down the line the best team of the Patrick Mahomes era, which is we always expect Mahomes to come back. And even if he starts the game poorly, you know, have some resilience and figure things out and put in a good effort. Well, yesterday we saw the defense do that for the Chiefs. You know, they were struggling. They gave up some big plays in the run game. And when they went an all-out blitz and gave up a big play down the field and kind of had some struggles in the first half, and then they completely shut out the Chargers, a really good offense in the second half. And so all of a sudden you're putting all these pieces together. You're going, well, what's the weakness of this Chiefs team right now? I mean, they still have Mahomes. And all of a sudden, you know, I saw a Bill Barnwell piece at ESPN.com today. He was trying to rank the best defenses in the NFL. And right now he has the Chiefs number two. So you potentially have a top five defense, and then you have Patrick Mahomes. And then, oh, by the way, the special teams, you've got Tommy Townsend, who is at worst a top five punter in the league, and Harrison Butker, who misses no kicks. This is a really good team and potentially at least the most well-rounded one of the Patrick Mahomes era, and potentially could be trending toward the best. And I think you saw that in both halves yesterday, which is the offense was great, amazing, over 300 passing yards in one half. And then the second half, the defense makes adjustments and completely shuts down a really good offense. And all of a sudden, you're kind of seeing everything click for the Chiefs, and they're showing the potential of how dangerous they potentially could be.
I know, Jesse, that the easy answer is Mahomes and Kelce and Andy Reid, but we see every week what are supposed to be good teams play really poorly, lose to what we think are bad teams. And this happens, like I said, every week in the NFL, but it never happens to the Chiefs ever. They never really play poorly in a game. Maybe you say Detroit, but they were in that game. They don't get beaten badly. Why?
It's a really good question. I mean, I would say Mahomes, right? Here was a crazy stat. Looking at this, Mahomes has now played 101 games. You know, we always talked about, you guys had me on as the KU beat writer, we always talked about the crazy Bill Self streak, which was they had more Big 12 conference titles than home losses, you know, and those things just didn't make much sense. Mahomes has now played 101 games, including the playoffs. Okay, so he has 101 opportunities to potentially lose a game by double digits. And he's been the season, this is his seventh year, but the first year he didn't really play. So he's had six opportunities to make the AFC Championship game, if I'm doing this right. Right now he has five AFC Championship game appearances and three double-digit losses. Except you have 101 chances to lose by double digits, and you have, whatever it is, six chances to go to the AFC Championship game. It's astounding. It's astounding that they don't ever get blown out of these games. And one player does make a huge difference, obviously, which is Patrick Mahomes. And you would give most of the credit to him, especially because the defense has not always been this good. It's your simple answer. It's probably your simple answer because it's the right answer, which is that dude is just so competitive and so good and knows the level it takes to be able to keep his team in games that it really has spoiled fans around here, I think, that – there just aren't stinkers for the Chiefs. You mentioned it. They just do not come out and play poor games like so many other teams do. And it's a credit to what they have rolling right now. And it's pretty amazing to watch.
Well, Jesse, I got to agree. You know, the defenses look good. Mahomes always look good. But you look at their last five games, and they've played the Bears, the Jets, the Vikings, the Broncos, and the Chargers. Not exactly world beaters. You got Denver next week, but then you get Miami and Philadelphia. Is that when we're going to actually see if this team's as good as we think they are?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be better teams. Now, I guess this is sort of week to week. You figure out small things about them, and everybody's capable of having a bad week. I mean, we just talked about that. You know, the Lions looking pretty good to those last week, and they have a bad week, and they get completely demolished by the Ravens. So, I mean, I'm not here to tell you that if the Chiefs get demolished by the Eagles that the whole season's done or that everything is bad or wrong. I mean, this is a week-to-week thing. Sometimes things go against you. Sometimes you're just not your best. Sometimes you got a couple injuries, whatever the case may be. But I would just say for the Chiefs, yes, we're going to learn more about them when they play these teams. I will say, though, that the Chargers have a good offense. I mean, you look statistically across the line, and the Chargers and Chiefs basically had the same level of offense going into this game. So for the Chiefs to be able to shut them out in the second half and completely shut down exactly or almost exactly what the Chargers wanted to do offensively. And I know Herbert's battling that finger injury, but he was plenty effective with it in previous weeks, still kind of managing around it. I thought that was pretty impressive by the Chiefs to be able to do that and showed something defensively even after they didn't get off to the best of starts.
Jessie Newell with us from the Kansas City Star. We're talking Chiefs. They're coming off a 2-touchdown win yesterday over the Chargers. So that game was still in doubt late, and Mecole Hardman returned a punt to set up the final Chiefs touchdown. And it's interesting to see the reaction to Mecole Hardman, a guy that had gotten away from the Chiefs. He was in New York playing for the Jets. They got him back a couple weeks ago. And, boy, the Chiefs players were just beside themselves after that return, and then I listened to some of the interviews after the game. Why is Mecole Hardman such a fit for the Chiefs, and can you help explain his popularity in that clubhouse?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. I think that is something I noticed immediately. If you saw his 50-yard return and how he popped up on the sideline and like the first three guys to celebrate him, I mean, this isn't like three dudes off the special teams block who, you know, are in for 12 snaps a game. Three guys that immediately jumped to celebrate with him are Jerick McKinnon, Travis Kelce, and Willie Gay. you know, three of the most tenured members of the Chiefs, oldest veterans, you know, guys that are the most well-respected, those sorts of things. So you're right. I mean, there is just a different level of respect. I went around the locker room. I actually wrote about this, wrote about McColl for, you know, my story yesterday, and just kind of tried to get a sense of exactly what you were asking, which is, why are guys so drawn to him? And it wasn't just in words in last Thursday's practice. I've never seen a player so happy to be a Chiefs practice guy. I mean, usually practice, some guys are kind of upbeat and peppy or whatever, but McColl would, like, catch a punt and then return it and do a couple wiggle moves just for fun, and then, like, would start dancing the music. And then he ran over to Sky Moore and, like, jumped on him to like, say hello again, all these sorts of things. So I talked to Sky. He said, hey, he's like a big brother to me. And, you know, he was one of the first guys that reached out to me last year, and he took me under his wing, and I have a lot of respect for him. And it was, I thought Sky said something interesting to me, too. It didn't make the story, but he said something to the effect of, like, you know, there's a lot of new receivers in the room for the Chiefs, but McColl reminds me of the Super Bowl. You know what I mean? He reminds him of the success, and he's a veteran player. So there's that. MVS talked on the podium last night. I asked MVS about McColl Hardman, and he said that they'd maintain a relationship even after McColl had left, and that they had become quick friends when they were both signed or both with Kansas City last year. And so he really respects his game. And I know Andy Reid talked about how smart McColl is and how he's able to pick up the offense in whatever, 2 or 3 days, be able to get out there for the certain plays they had him in. So I just think the guys not only have a level of respect for him because of who he is and how he's an energy giver. You can see that he's excited to be at practice, excited to spark the team out there with his big return. But also, you know, we're all human too. I think they felt bad for him in New York. I think they thought he was being misused or underutilized, and they're really happy to see him succeed here and knew what he was going through. Obviously the Chiefs played the Jets. A lot of those guys talked to him on the field before the game, knew he was frustrated, and he gets another chance. He gets another opportunity. And it was kind of crazy last night in front of his locker. He's the new addition, so they kind of have to cram him in a locker that's not being used. So they put him between the running backs and the quarterbacks, kind of crammed him in the middle of those guys just because they didn't have another locker for him. And Patrick Mahomes tried to come back to his locker after the game, and there was no room for him because there was about 30 reporters around McColl Hardman at his locker. And so Mahomes very loudly said, hey, this isn't going to work. You know, this McColl guy can't have this much attention every game because his locker can't be this close to mine because I can't even get to my locker. He's so popular. But I think guys are genuinely happy for him because they know who he is. They know his personality. They know he gives energy, and they know he's better than what he showed with the Jets. And now he's going to get to show with the Chiefs, and I think they're all excited about that.
I guess I'll be the guy to go there this week, Jesse. Taylor Swift, she's basically on the team at this point. So when are they going to make her available to the media? And how did she end up taking a picture with Bernie Kosar?
Well, these are all good questions. So Andy Reid, really quickly after the game, somebody asked him about Travis, who's only getting better. And Andy Reid said, brought up on his own, basically said, hey, it seems like he's getting better, and Taylor is welcome around here as much as she wants to be based off his performances. I'm sure you guys have seen the stats now. Like,
yes.
We have the with Taylor and without Taylor stats for Travis Kelce, and it seems to be something there, guys. I mean, over 100 yards every time. They might have to, you know, cancel this Eras tour in South America if Andy Reid has anything to do with it. But I don't think we're going to get her in a press conference. You know, it is kind of weird walking down to the Chiefs' availability because you kind of keep your head on a swivel. You're not really sure who you're going to run into down there. It really could be anybody. It could be Donna Kelce. It could be Taylor Swift. You're just not sure at this point. And the Bernie Kosar thing is kind of random. But remember, Travis Kelce is from the Cleveland, Ohio area. Bernie Kosar, obviously a very famous Browns quarterback. And that sure appeared to be a picture taken in Kelce's new mansion that he bought to get a little bit of privacy with Taylor Swift. So
okay.
I guess if you're Travis Kelce at this point, you invite all the celebrities over to your house, including the one that you're dating, and that's how Bernie Kosar and Taylor Swift get together for a picture.
Final moments here.
I love it.
It's fun. I'll tell you that, as I posted on Twitter yesterday, I like the Chiefs more than I've ever liked the Chiefs, and I'm not a Chiefs fan. I'm normally not a bandwagon fan, but this is all fun, and I get a kick out of the naysayers who want it not to be fun. Those miserable people, Jesse, how miserable can you be?
Yeah, it's true. And, I mean, after a game like yesterday, it really is fun for the Chiefs, and you see all the potential pieces of what they can be. So they got a fun coach. They got a fun quarterback. They've got a team that the whole nation is now watching, and, yeah, right now, it's all roses for the Chiefs. Everything has kind of been fun lately.
And it looks like Nick Bolton's going to miss 6 weeks of action with his wrist injury. How difficult is that for the Chiefs defense to endure?
You know, last year I would have told you pretty difficult, and this year I would tell you going to hurt them, but not as much, just because of the overwhelming depth that they have. And this is kind of where their defense has taken a huge step this year, is that they have other guys who can fill in. And we've seen it previous weeks. Drew Tranquil has stepped right in that Mike linebacker position, and we wonder in the preseason, why would you sign Drew Tranquil when you have other linebackers? Well, this is why. In case one of these injuries happens, you feel good about the replacements behind him. So half step back for the Chiefs, but if Drew Tranquil stays healthy, then I think that they're going to be just fine in there, and that's a reason this defense might be better than it has been in past years.
All right. Always enjoy talking with you. Jessie Newell from the Kansas City Star. Jessie, thank you.
Appreciate it, guys. And, hey, whenever you're thinking about it, just know Taylor Swift's following me around right now. That's really how this
goes. There you go. Yeah, the Chiefs are fun. I mean, I don't think there's any other word for it. They've been fun to Chiefs fans for quite some time. Now they have – what element are they missing? They've got it all. They've got everything –
No, but that's the way it always works with teams and stuff. There are a lot of teams like this, and you're right, they are fun. And the people that don't like them, it's because they don't like the Chiefs, usually because they win. And that's the same thing.
But I never liked the Chiefs.
That was the same thing with New England when they had Brady. Well, I mean, you didn't either loved them or you hated them. There was no real in-between with that team. And it's kind of the same way with the Chiefs. I don't think it's a big deal. They are a fun team. They're fun to watch. They're explosive.
They're likable.
They are.
I mean, I'm admitting that. There have been many years where the Chiefs haven't been likable for me.
Well, the Todd Haley years. Todd Haley years.
No, many years.
Like when?
Like entire life.
Like what was unlikable about the Chiefs?
I didn't like them.
But what was unlikable about them?
The way, you know. You have nothing.
You have nothing.
I just didn't care for them.
Okay, but that doesn't mean they're unlikable inherently.
For me,
that just means you didn't like them.
Much the same way the Guardians are.
By the way,
the Indiana Pacers.
Oh, I love the Pacers.
Can't stand them.
By the way, we're interviewing Stephen Vogt for our managerial vacancy. That'll be good. Hate it, but let's go.
That was a great tidbit to throw in there. Thanks.
Yeah, we all care.
Yeah. Please keep us up today.
Hey, I've got the microphone. I get to talk about stuff people don't care about sometimes.
Well, no, pretty much all the time. You've had the Pacers. And Stephen Vogt already today.
It's a good day.
Yeah, and that's where you're going.
Yeah. Tomorrow on the show, Kevin Saul, Wichita State Athletic Director, will join us, as well as ESPN's NBA writer, Mark Spears.
Oh, really?
Will be on the show.
Oh, do I have some questions for him?
I'm glad I ain't going to be here.
He seems to know a lot about the NBA except for one team.
That's too bad.
The Pacers.
I assume that's the Magic.
What are you pointing at there, dudes?
There's a huge spider walking right behind you. There he is.
Oh, my God.
I know. That thing's huge.
Why didn't you tell Bob? Are you trying to get him killed?
What in the world?
Is that a brown recluse?
Well, wait a minute.
I don't know, but that thing's huge.
Well, wait. Don't just stand there
closer.
And laugh.
He's getting closer.
Kill it.
Oh, no, it's not. It's still alive.
Oh, no. Poor spider. It didn't do anything to you.
Well, I didn't do anything to him.
Killed it.
No, he just fell down. He'll crawl up my leg here in a minute.
Good.
I'll be in the ER.
Hope
he
gives you gangrene.
Oh, really? That's what you hope? You want me to get a leg cut off?
Not necessarily. We'll catch it early.
Well, now I feel like something's crawling on me right now.
It might be.
You know what? I could have been just fine without knowing that spider was back here.
Well, I didn't want it. What if it is a jumping spider and jumped on you, and then you wouldn't at least been aware?
It went under something.
Good. Run away, spider.
Well, it's fine. It's far enough away from me. I'm good.
And it was a brown recluse.
Well, you should have probably dusted
it. I got bit
it.
By one of those one time. It was pretty awful.
I laughed.
No, you didn't. They wanted to, like, cut me open. Well, that's not going to happen.
I told him, go right ahead.
You weren't there, but that's great.
where did it happen?
It happened at home, I think. Since remember, we were at the NCAA, I think it was in St. Louis. We were at the NCAA tournament, and it was still kind of festering, and I had to take all those huge antibiotics for it. Because it hurt bad.
Well, I don't want that to happen.
Yeah, it was kind of fun. Don't worry about it.
You won't know until later.
Well, good point.
Yeah, exactly. So it's nothing to worry about right now.
869-1240, the IHOP hotline, brought to you by IHOP. Now featuring a pumpkin spice cold foam cold brew. Wow, that sounds so bad. I mean, excuse me, that sounds so good.
Why would you, man?
What do you mean? It sounds
like
great.
We've got a lot of title sponsors around here, and you could just denigrate.
No, I meant to say, who wouldn't want an ice cold brew? Pumpkin spice.
Well, the five of us do.
You'd like one, wouldn't you, dude?
Oh, for sure. Guaranteed. With some pancakes.
Is there any flavor better than pumpkin?
Yes.
What are your three favorite flavors?
Peppermint.
Strawberry.
Oh, I can't stand peppermint.
Well, wasn't that? You asked me the question.
I did.
But he's right. You're right. You are right. Peppermint sucks.
Oh, no. Peppermint
Didn't we have this conversation?
Yeah, I thought we did.
I'm shocked. I've never met anyone who liked peppermint.
Peppermint. Peppermint chocolate.
Chocolate
too. Is chocolate
peppermint mocha.
No. Give me three. What?
Pumpkin. I like pumpkin.
You like the chocolate mint ice cream, don't you?
Yes.
Ugh.
I like my chocolate, dark chocolate with peppermint. Peppermint bark is my favorite snack. Favorite chocolate, peppermint bark. No question. Not even close.
Wow.
Not even close.
What's second behind peppermint?
Probably pumpkin.
And then third?
Third. Probably might have to go, I don't know. That's tough. I can give you those two for sure. Third one would be tough. Caramel, maybe.
Caramel's a good one.
Caramel, maybe.
Strawberry
might be three.
Strawberry would be
in there, definitely
chocolate.
Top five.
Here are my top three. I've just thought of it. Pumpkin's four. I love pumpkin. One is cinnamon.
Really?
Two is caramel.
Caramel.
Is strawberry. You know what? Here's a serious threat.
Number three is chocolate.
Here's a serious threat. I will knock you out.
Rack that.
Why is there an A in caramel?
It's caramel. Or caramel. Or most people just say caramel, but you go caramel.
What if I want to pronounce it correctly?
Then go for it.
Caramel. I mean, if you're going by look it up in the dictionary.
Okay.
Nobody would look at that word. Somebody coming here from outer space would not look at that word and say,
"Take us to
where
your
can I get some
caramel.
Caramel. Huh?
Everybody says caramel.
You just said caramel.
No, I didn't put the extra A.
You did.
I don't think I did. I think I just rolled my R a little bit.
You made it three syllables. So cinnamon, caramel, and strawberry with pumpkin.
What do you eat cinnamon on?
Oh.
Like toast?
Have you ever had a cinnamon roll?
Yeah, they're fine.
The problem with cinnamon
rolls.
But
they're not cinnamon.
Yeah,
that's the glaze that you're after.
No, I agree.
No,
I like the cinnamon part, but it's got to be all through it. If it's just on the top, then it's
right. You
got to
have
good.
You got to have a healthy dose of cinnamon.
Yes, then they're fantastic.
What's your three?
Strawberry chocolate?
And you better pronounce them just exactly.
Chocolate.
you know, you got to laugh out of that once.
It's still funny. Strawberry. I don't know what number three is. Orange.
Orange?
Yeah.
Lemon? What kind of freak would confess to liking orange?
Orange.
Flavor?
I don't know. What is orange?
Orange soda is pretty good.
It is.
I haven't had an orange soda in 50 years, I'll bet.
Lemon pastry is good. Lemon cookies, those lemon
Lemon's
cookies.
Lemon's in
that
the top five.
Lemon can be. Lemon may be five to seven.
Have you had the lemon Girl Scout cookies? I think they have them.
Hey. Cherry's a pretty good one, too.
No, I wouldn't put it in my top five. I don't mind it. It's not like I would say no.
It's a pretty good one.
It's not bad. Maybe later, closer to the top 10. 8 to 10 range.
It's a pretty good top 10 list.
That is top 10 good top flavors. List.
What?
Top 10 flavors. I could see it. Maybe we'll do that Wednesday.
I can't believe you don't like cinnamon rolls.
They're okay.
I'm with Jeff on this. I don't mind them, but I don't go out to look for them.
No, I'd rather have a donut.
Yeah, because unless it's unbelievable, or a cinnamon roll, they're just kind of meh.
So yeah, when I stop at a donut store, here's something I've tried lately: the apple fritter.
Those are good.
Those are very good.
So maybe apples in your favorite flavors. Don't you like apple pie?
I do like apple pie. I wouldn't pick apple pie as my favorite pie.
Oh, I'd put blueberry up in mine, too. I like blueberry.
See, blueberry's flavor. I don't get it.
I like it. Blueberry, peppermint. Oh, I got them all.
Well, they put so much sugar in it. It could be anything. It could be a blue piece of cardboard and you
No
eat it.
Way. I just like blueberries.
Yeah.
I mean, when I used to, on the farm back home, you just go and pick some blueberries. You eat them like that. You don't need to add sugar to them.
Well, they got no taste.
They do have taste. It's not like eating cardboard. Come on, Bob.
Similar. Well, we didn't get any baseball talk in there. We will
got plenty
in the
of
next
time.
Segment. Because we're going to talk about the Astros-Rangers. Game 4, first pitch, 4:05 today. And then tonight, Game 6, Phillies-Diamondbacks. I expect baseball to be over.
Wait a minute. Are you sure about that order?
Yes, again, I am.
I'm pretty sure Game 7's in prime time.
Yeah. That is.
Game 7's at 7 o'clock.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Sir, yes, sir.
Are you sure about that?
Sir, yes, sir.
Absolutely.
Well, that's better. But that's not how I read it earlier.
Well, we're just.
As I was having
letting you know what's going on
earlier, I could have sworn.
No, it's 4.
Too much sugar. Went to your
407.
Head.
7:03,
I think. By golly, I'm going to verify it before we take a break.
Yeah, because don't listen to the two of us who have both verified
you
it.
You two clowns don't have a clue. You're right. Diamondbacks, Phillies.
Of course. And then their potential Game 7 would be in primetime tomorrow.
Rangers, Astros. That's the order of the games. We'll be back to talk about them after this.